العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه وأهل بيته وأزواجه وذرياته أجمعين أما بعد. Yesterday we started discussion about Luqman عليه السلام. Who was Luqman عليه السلام? He was not a Nabi, but he was that individual chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a lot of hikmat and a lot of wisdom. And when that man, he came and he asked Luqman alayhi salam, "O Luqman, how did you attain and how did you get all of this wisdom?" Luqman alayhi salam, he told him the different means and the things that he used to do that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he then bestowed this hikmat and this wisdom upon him. And we also spoke about what is hikmat and what is wisdom. That wisdom is the changing of the aqwal and the statements and the, what you know as an individual into a'mal. This is hikmat and wisdom. As well as ulama explain hikmat and wisdom as such a speech and such a kalam that when it is heard, it goes into the heart and you remember it. And not only that, you are able to convey it and you are able to tell it to other people. And in the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he keeps a passage and he keeps a few advices where Luqman alayhi salam, he gave towards his son. And while each and every single one of us, we may not be parents, every single one of us is a child. So it's as though Luqman alayhi salam, he is speaking to us the awaz and the advices like for us as well. Luqman alayhi salam, being the hakim, being the wise one speaking to us. Luqman alayhi salam and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has it in the Holy Quran. وَإِذْ قَالَ لُقْمَانُ لِبْنِهِ And when Luqman alayhi salam, he said to his son, وَهُوَ يَعِذُهُ And he was advising him, يَا بُنَيَّ That, oh my son. And bunayya, it's a term that's used to refer to a small child. But his child wasn't small according to the commentators of the Holy Quran. Rather, he was old. But as a father towards your child is always small to you. So therefore he addresses him as Ya Bunayya, a statement of affection and a statement of love. So in Arabic, when it is you want to call your child, your young one, with affection and love, you say Ya Bunayya, oh my little one, oh my child. So therefore Luqman alayhi salam, this is how he starts his advice to his son, with love, with karam, with a lot of hikmat and wisdom in the wordings themselves. He doesn't call him by any name. He doesn't call him by something that will push him away. Rather, he uses words to draw him closer. He says, Ya Bunayya, O my son. And the first advice that he gives to him, La tushrik billah, is that you are not to ascribe partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That, O my son, as you live on the face of this earth, and as your life traverses and you go along, the first thing that you ought to know is that you are to never ever ascribe partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it is we are to read the whole Quran, we'll recognize and we'll see that very rarely does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala try to prove the existence of himself. He doesn't prove from an angle that there isn't a God. Some people are believing there isn't a God and he tries to prove that there is an ilah. Allah doesn't do that in the Holy Quran. Because since time immemorial, since Adam alayhi salam came to the face of this earth, it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that was worshipped. And it was only afterwards then idolatry and then all the different things started to come about on the face of the earth. And a normal human mind, as the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he expounds and he explains, kullu mawludin yuladu ala al-fitra, that every single child that's born, he borns in a state of fitra, with that ability to recognize that that is right and that which is wrong. He borns in that type of state. That when it is a child, he grows up without any type of training from a religious perspective. Even his mind tells him that there is something to be a God. There is some ilah that's there. Hence the reason. People in this aim and this looking for who this ilah and this God is, some of them turn towards the stone because they are looking for this ilah and they are looking for this God. They turn to trees. Some of them turn to other human beings and they turn to other people. But they have that concept and that belief within them that a God exists. Who is that God is where they make their error in and where they make their mistakes in. So when we look at the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't prove the existence of an ilah. Rather, what Allah does in the Quran is prove who is the God. That turn your attention, move it away from the rock and turn it to Allah. Move it from the sun and put it on Allah. Move it from the stars and put it on Allah. Move it from the makhluk and the creation and the human beings and put it on Allah. Move it from all of these things and put it on Allah. This is what Allah does in the Holy Quran. That's why when Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was arguing with his people, the angle and the approach that Ibrahim alayhi salam he used was a brilliant one. That, you know, maybe our ilan, maybe our God is the moon. Then he tells them to bring about the rational and the thinking in them. But you know when it is that the morning comes, the moon disappears. Doesn't exist anymore. So therefore, to a mind that's thinking at that point in time will recognize, well, this moon, it cannot be a god. Which means that in their minds, they believed in an ilah, but who was the ilah they were mistaken about? So therefore, he brings about a second argument, that maybe the sun is the ilah because the sun is brighter than the moon. Rational and logical thinking. So the people going along with that thinking at that time, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he then tells to them now, that you know this cannot be it. Because you know at night time the sun it goes away. So maybe then the being who created the sun and moon, that is the ilah then. So therefore he coached them and he taught them how to reach towards that understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't go at length in proving that a God exists. He just changes the minds of the people to who is the ilah and who is the God. So the first advice in which Luqman alayhi salam is given to his son is, O my son, O my beloved son, la tushrik billah. Do not ascribe partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the Holy Quran, in Surah Al-Fatiha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, time and again, he tells humanity that he is one. First ayat in Surah Al-Fatiha. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. That all the praises that you can amass, all with your great understanding, Allah has blessed you with words. All the praises that you can come up with as creation, it belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You may put your praise towards creation, but really and truly that praise is deserving for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Example, a person, he fixes your car, or maybe you're sick and you go to a doctor and they do all and you feel better. From then all your heart's praise come out for that doctor or come out for that individual. You praise him and you praise him well. He deserves to be praised because he has done you some sort of khidmat and he has done you some sort of kindness. But really and truly, the being who had blessed him and blessed that individual with solving your issues and solving your problem, it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So really and truly, all the praises that you had given to him, he is really and not the one totally entitled to all of that praise. Rather, the praise is really for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whether it is you praise Allah or not, he is that being who is deserving of all praises. So Allah is telling us in the Holy Quran, nobody else is deserving of all of that praise. It is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, Alhamdu, all the praise. It is for who? Alhamdulillah, it is for Allah. And who is this Allah? Allah says, Rabbil Alameen, he is Rabb. When we go to Aqiqah functions, normally the people who give advice, they talk about tarbiyatul awlad, upbringing of children. And it comes from the same word, Rabb, tarbiyatun Rabbun. So therefore, who is a Rabb? Ulama explain, a Rabb is that being who brings you from one stage to another until you reach to a stage of perfection. And every stage that he brings you, you are perfect. Ulama explain, if we look at the inception of a human being, that when it is he came about, firstly, initially, it was just the coming together of a sperm and an egg. That was all, that was the starting and the beginning. And Allah brought you from that stage, from one stage to another, from one stage to another, until you came out as a baby. And then you grew up, now it is you're a big man. You came into a state from such insignificance towards a state of perfection. Now, Allah says, this is a Rabb. I brought you, I did your tarbiyat, your upbringing, from a stage of nothingness until perfection now. So when you go to Aqiqah, you talk about tarbiyatul awlad. This child knows nothing. So therefore, you are bringing him from a stage of nothing into good akhlaq, good characteristics, good moral. So Allah tells us in the Holy Quran as well, who is this Allah, the one who has brought you from one stage to another until you reach the perfection now? Take a plant, take anything you want to see in this dunya and this world, Allah brought it from nothingness into perfection. Allah is the one who had done it. He is the one who had brought it about into existence. So Allah is saying in the Holy Quran, all the praises belongs to that one who is the Rabb. And this is a Rabb, translated in the Quran as a Lord, but cannot even come close to what really and truly the meaning of a Rabb is. When we say that he is the Lord, we don't even know what Lord actually means. But he is a Rabbul Alameen. We understand what is a Rabb now. And he is Lord of what? The entire of the Alameen, the entire of the universe. Every single thing that exists, Allah brought it about. It wasn't existing before, Allah brought it about. The earth wasn't here, Allah brought it about. The sky wasn't there, Allah is the one who had brought it. Allah is the one who brought it into creation. The moon wasn't there, the sun wasn't there. The oceans weren't there, and the animals weren't there. Nothing was there. Allah is the one who brought it into existence. He is a Rabbul Alameen. So in the very first ayat, Allah is telling humanity that nobody else again can be this Ilah and this God. Nobody again is deserving of worship excepting that one who is deserving of all praise and that one who created every single thing. Very next ayat of the Holy Quran, after saying Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Allah then tells humanity, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Allah is that one who is a Rahman. He is that one who is very, very beneficent. He is a Rahim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very, very merciful. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Arabs at that time, they didn't understand and they didn't know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had these qualities with him as well, of a Rahman and of a Rahim. That's why when Umar radiallahu ta'ala, when he saw the parchments of Surah Taha, and he saw Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, he knew what was Bismillah, but what was a Rahman and a Rahim, it was unfamiliar words to them. A person being beneficent, a person being so merciful, who is this being? Allah then goes on to tell humanity after Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, he is Maliki Yawm al-Din. He is the total supreme owner of the day of Deen, the day of judgment. When it is we stand before Allah, every single thing, because the day of judgment is a great day, for those who believe in an afterlife, everybody believe that they are going to stand and have to give an account to this being. So therefore Allah is saying to humanity, on that day, the only individual who has control on that day is going to be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Had any other being who you all recognize and worship had a say, then on that day they will have a say. Allah says, on that day though, they will have no say. It is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is Maliki Yawm al-Din. Hence the reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then told humanity, Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'een. That after you recognize that he is the one deserving of all praise, he is the one controlling every single thing, Rahman and Rahim, the day of judgment belongs to him, then O human being, who then again shall you worship? Who then again shall you ask for help? Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. You alone is deserving of all worship. You, Allah, is the only one deserving of us to ask for assistance and ask for help. So in Surah Al-Fatiha itself, Allah tells and is teaching humanity about his wahdaniyat and his oneness, and that make sure, human beings, you do not ascribe any partners to me, just as how Luqman alayhi salam is advising his son. The Arabs, though, in their days, they did recognize Allah. When it is that the Kaaba was going to be destroyed, Abdul Muttalib, he was the governor, the one in charge at that time. When he heard Abraha was coming to destroy the Kaaba, he told all the Meccans who were there that leave the place, go towards the hillocks and go towards the mountain passes, The Lord of the Kaaba will protect his house. All of you all leave and you all go. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran, he calls out to them, لِإِلَافِ قُرَيْشِ إِلَافِهِمْ رِحْلَةَ الشِّتَاءِ وَالصَّيْفِ فَلْيَعْبُدُوا رَبَّ هَذَا الْبَيْتِ. O Abdul Muttalib, you recognize and you knew that there is a Lord in charge of the Kaaba. Allah sent Suratul Quraysh towards them. O Qurayshi people, I want you all to stop worshipping all those 360 ilah that you have and Allah, and only worship Rabba Hazal Bayt, the Lord of this house alone. They knew Allah, but attached to Allah, they knew our 360 idols as well. So therefore, when it was asked to them, so who created the heavens and who created the earth? They used to say Allah. So therefore, they had a sense of monotheism in it as well. But in the Holy Quran, Allah still called that shirk as well. Because they used to say that they worship all of these deities and all of these beings. Because in worshipping these beings are so close and revered to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that if we worship them, the one in charge of this, then he is going to give us prosperity. This next being, he's going to give us goodness. This other being, he's going to give us children. This other being, he's going to make our travels good. So therefore, they thought to themselves, if they worship all of these deities, then Allah is going to make every single thing easy. Allah also called that shirk in the Holy Quran as well. So therefore, those people and those individuals who recognize Allah as the supreme ilah, but other ilahs of lesser degree, that is also shirk, Allah calls it in the Holy Quran as well. So this is also another type of shirk that existed in the time of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that he came to abolish and he came to wipe away. Another type of shirk in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he spoke about, was that shirk whereby people used to worship the graves of the saints and the graves of the pious people and the righteous people. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala says, when the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam was about to die, he pulled his sheet over his head. And when it is, he then removed the sheet from his head, he said to those around, O Aisha, O people, the Jews and the Christians, they have a curse upon them. And the curse that they have upon them is that they took the graves of their pious people and their prophets as sanctuaries and places of worship. O Aisha, when it is I die, make sure that you people and the Ummah do not take my grave and my place of burial as a place of worship. Make sure that that does not occur at all. Make sure that no worshipping of these things occur. People make sajda towards graves. People bow down towards graves. Hence the reason Salatul Janazah is not to be performed in the graveyard, so that it will not have any sort of similitude that you are worshipping those who are dead and those who have gone before. No Salatul Janazah in the graveyard. Perform it outside, perform it somewhere else. And at the same time, while it's called Salatul Janazah, it has no sajda in it. No bowing before any mayit and any dead. None of that is to take place in Salatul Janazah. None of that is to occur. So therefore, towards an onlooker, it will never seem that you are praying to any dead. None of it at all. Allah and the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam prohibited any sort of similitude towards praying to the dead or praying to graves. So therefore, that's also prohibited, to worship and to believe that if it is we were to do these different things, it will gain us some closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another aspect of shirk, what is actually dominant in society and in and within the Muslim societies as well, is people, they read horoscopes and they believe in zodiac signs. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in one tradition, he says, whosoever believes that the rain falls because of the positioning of stars, have disbelieved in Allah and believed that the stars have then become their ilah and their God. Hence the reason it's not permissible to read and to believe in any of these things. And you hear Muslims even saying, well, he born in October, that's why he just behaved like that. He's a September, that's why he like that. He born in February, so you know he like this. So therefore, their beliefs and characteristics of an individual, they are connected and they are linked towards things that are shirky as well. So as Muslims, think these sorts of aqaid and these sorts of beliefs, they are to be shunned. They are not to be associated with at all. We take our deen and our religion, and we take tawheed and we take oneness to Allah very, very seriously. We don't ascribe anything towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any tashabbu and any resemblance towards it as well, we stay very, very far away from it. So all of these are things wherein Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He revealed in the Holy Quran. And Luqman alayhi salam is telling his son that, O my son, ya bunayya, O my beloved son, la tushrik billah, that you are not to ascribe any partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one other type of shirk, and there are many different types of shirk, in which people also involve themselves in, and even Muslims sometimes, is that they're going towards soothsayers, and they're going towards these mysterious types of people for answers towards their problems and for them to give prophecies towards their lives. They will carry and they will do sacrifices for them and all these different things in an aim and in a hope that they will tell them what their future actually holds. All of these things are connected towards shirk. So much so, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whosoever were to go towards a soothsayer, and who to were to go towards these people for 40 days, your salat is not even accepted. None of your salat is accepted for 40 days. Imagine you still have to perform salat so that you will not be punished for neglecting salat, yet still no thawab and no rewards for salat. Nothing at all you are going to get for worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, all of these are different forms of shirk that people involve themselves in. Jinn worship, people worship the jinns, people worship graves, people do all of these different things. From Muslims as well, Muslim communities involve themselves in these. So sometimes we hear about shirk and we think about only worshiping a stone or only worshiping an idol. All of these are different branches that come and fall under shirk as well. And one other shirk that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he spoke about. He spoke about the minor shirk. And the minor shirk, as it comes in the hadith, is what the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. And he informed the people that the minor shirk, it's to do ibadat and to do worship and to do things, not for the sake of Allah, but for show. And the Rasul, he gave an example that you will be performing salat, but when it is you send somebody has entered and come close to you, all of a sudden your salat becomes longer, your ruku becomes perfect, your sajda becomes so humble, your dua becomes loud and you start to cry now. All of these different things. You were not doing it before, all of a sudden in the gatherings you have started to do it. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, this is the secret shirk. This is a minor shirk. It's not as the ones we discussed just now, but it is also a type of shirk. Because now you are playing with your ibadat between Allah and doing it for somebody else. You are playing with it. So therefore ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify our hearts from riya, from doing things for show. Let it be done mukhlisan lillah, sincerely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah continues in the Holy Quran in the same ayat. Inna shirka la zulmun azim. Because, O my son, certainly ascribing partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's the greatest and the biggest zulm and wrong that you can ever do. And what is a zulm and what is oppression, as we will say? What is zulm? Zulm is the taking something from its original place and putting it somewhere else. This is what is called zulm. Zulm is the taking of something from its rightful, correct place and putting it somewhere else. So therefore, worship is only for Allah. So if you worship something else, you are taking worship from its rightful place and you are putting it somewhere else. So therefore, this is called zulm. This is oppression. So therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Holy Quran that shirk and ascribing partners to Allah, there is no greater sin that a person can do than this sin that is called shirk. That is ascribing partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That while it is a person, he may not pray. And while it is a person, he may not pay his zakat. If it is, he is still a Muslim and he believes in Allah, he ought to believe in Allah. And he believes in the Rasul and he has the tenets of Islam covered. On the day of Qiyamah, although he may go towards Jahannam if he is not forgiven by Allah to be purified, one day he will still come towards Jannah and he will still come to paradise. But that person, unfortunately, who would ascribe partners to Allah, and he dies upon that state, Even though you give your whole wealth in charity, you become the greatest of individuals in akhlaq and characteristics. In the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will have no thawab and no rewards with him, and your whole entire life will have gone to waste, and your whole entire life in hereafter will be in Jahannam. So the most important thing, and the most important thing for each and every single individual, is this tawheed and oneness in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the first thing that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to teach was the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That la ilaha illallah. No deity except Allah. Negation first. Nothing, absolutely nothing exists except in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Well, let me explain. When we stand for salat as well, when it is we raise our hands, the raising of the hands, it symbolizes that there is no ilah that exists anymore except in Allahu Akbar, except in Allah who is the greatest of all beings. Hence the reason and one of the hikmah that ulama give why we raise our hands before we begin salat. That to signify no ilah exists except in Allah who is Al-Akbar, Allah who is the greatest. So the first advice that Luqman gives to his son, and the first advice to humanity, to every single individual, make sure that you don't ascribe any partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this in reality, it's the greatest sin that you can ever do. I hope and pray that Allah keeps our hearts pure. He guides us to the straight path. He makes us never ever commit this sin, never even come close to it, any form of it, any resemblance to it. I hope and pray that Allah protects us and our families. He protects our generations to come. He forgives us for whatever wrongs we have done. I hope and pray that these advices, it actually sinks into our hearts. It becomes real advices, like how Luqman alayhi salam will give. That it will sink into the heart, we'll understand, and we'll tell other people about it as well. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Shati'in fi yadayhi kaffaratun lil khataya wa shati'in fi yadayhi kaffaratun lil khataya. هدايا